Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who is bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and Son Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Before this evening's service, Nicole and I met in the study as we usually do, and as she arrived early, he gave me an opportunity to play one of my favorite pre-worship experience games. See if I can stump the seminarian. It's very hard to do because she is well-trained and most knowledgeable. So I said to Nicole, "Why is this night called Maundy, Thursday?" Now, I won't quiz the congregation, but how many of you are quite certain that you know what the reference to is in Maundy, Thursday? Put up your hand if you wish. Well, it's good we're having this little review. We will call this night Maundy, Thursday. And it's We commemorate the gathering of the disciples in that upper room. And a beginning point for that gathering was Jesus tying a towel around his waist and proceeding to wash the feet of each and every disciple who was there gathered. Wow. Can you imagine Jesus kneeling before you and washing your feet? Tonight in Rome, the Pope will reenact in this solemn service that event by going and kneeling before the average individual Christian and washing their feet. And as he does so, in the background there will be sung from the liturgy for this evening these words, Mandatum novum dovobis, ut delegatum sendensum sissum, delexi vos. Behold, I give you a new command, the mandatum, the Maundy. I give you a new commandment as we begin this final gathering with Jesus in the upper room. I give you a new commandment, as you love one another, as I have loved you. Most of you know that I am an insulin-dependent diabetic, and as such, feet are very important to me. My doctor regularly reminds me that every day I am required to examine my feet. I look for blisters and corns and calluses and cuts and bruises. I have to be attentive because not being attentive to one's feet, in my case, could be disastrous. I know something about feet. I know that of all my body parts, my feet travel and travel me through all the walkways and byways and experiences that I have every day. My feet take me into the hospital room. My feet recently took me into the labor and delivery area. My feet take me here, there, and sometimes my feet, sometimes my feet get me into places I really shouldn't be. I know something else about feet. They're not always that attractive, are they? Sometimes they're downright stinky. There's the toe jam issue. When your feet are there in front of someone, they can see your travels. They can see what's come into contact with you. They can see your bumps and your bruises and your blisters and the wear and tear of dragging this body around. Revealing your feet to Jesus was extremely an act of acute vulnerability for those disciples. It was base. It was something that you would give a servant, a slave to take care of, not your Lord, not your leader. But Jesus comes and kneels and washes his disciples' feet. In that holy evening, he reminds us that we can be transparent with him. He knows, he understands, he loves, he heals, he applies the washing balm. We learn a lot in this final gathering. Before he goes to the cross, we learn a lot about community. We learn that his most most important thought, even as he goes to be arrested and murdered by people he loved, was that we love one another, that we tend to one another's feet, that we gather around the table of the Lord, where he feeds us, that we are a chosen people to be in the family of God. Yes, next time I go see my doctor, undoubtedly at some point, he'll say, "How's your feet?" Perhaps we should ask that of ourselves tonight. How's your feet? Jesus comes to wash. Amen.